Well, ladies and gentlemen, I will explain in this short course how to do analog design in nanometer CMOS once you end up in weak inversion, low currents, and that I will do with the new EKV BSM6 models. Why analog design? Because it's the main limitation for mixed signal. And what we have in analog design, it follows digital in the sense that we get lower and lower channel lengths all the time. Lower and lower channel lengths. Meaning that because of the lower channel lengths, we get higher and higher speeds. Meaning that actually, when we make conventional frequency amplifiers, we end up deeper in weak inversion. Deeper in weak inversion. So how do you do that if you have filters at conventional frequencies like 1, 5, 10, 20, 30, even 100 megahertz? Well, the new model that I'm going to use to show you how to do design at those moderate frequencies have several advantages. It was actually introduced to be able to have continuity through VDS when a transistor turns around as a switch, for example. Sources and drains exchange all the times. How do you calculate distortion in there? Things like that. It also includes the AKV model, the Enskrum-Nachri-Vitos model, which was the model combining weak and strong inversion. And they are based on different assumptions on charges and potentials in the channel I'm not going to talk about here. The two parameters I would like to talk about are actually the inversion coefficient. Inversion coefficient, which is going to replace the VGS minus VT, which was the conventional overdrive voltage that you use to bias a transistor. And the other one represents velocity saturation. Velocity saturation, which is something like 10 to the 7 centimeter per second, which is actually used in circuitry by theta. All that is replaced now by lambda C. How do those two parameters, how are they going to be determined when you make an amplifier? And I'll start off with a little bit of modeling. Modeling in the sense that modeling, as you know, for a MOS device has three different models. We have a model in the middle current region, average currents, intermediate values of VGS minus VT. We have a model here on the left-hand side, which is weak inversion. This I'm going to call strong inversion in the middle, and there is another model on the right. In the middle current region, we have that good old expression we have been using for 40 years, actually coming from Schumann Hodges, saying that the current is simply proportional to the VGS minus VT square, and is proportional to size, and proportional to some technology, where Kp includes mobility, for example, and some capacitances. The K prime also includes N, which I'm going to need in weak inversion in just a moment. The N, which is basically a ratio of two capacitances, the bulk to channel capacitance and the gate to channel capacitance. So those are all well-known parameters for whoever has worked in this region here in a MOS transistor. Now, of course, we have to add weak inversion because the higher the frequency in the technology, the lower the current can be for moderate frequency. And when I add the weak inversion region, the first thing to notice is that we connect it in this point, which is a real anchor point for the model. This is strong inversion, this is weak inversion, and this is the anchor point. The point here, the voltage there, is this one. It's slightly larger than VT, about, yes, same N, about 70 millivolt larger than the VT. And we take the current in that point as the reference current, called the specific current. And the specific current is the current used in the model on weak inversion, which shows that indeed we have an exponential there with NKT over Q, the same N as before. It's an exponential, so it gives you a straight line. What is shown on the linear curve here is a straight line on the log curve. That's weak inversion. And now we need a model covering those two, which has main parameters, the 70 millivolts larger than the VT, and as another parameter, that specific current, my reference current, to which I'm going to refer my other currents. So here it is. I normalize my VGS minus V2 to 2 NKT over Q. I normalize the current to my specific current, my reference current, which includes size and K prime and 2 NKT over Q, those two basic parameters which occur again and again and again. And once I have normalized to my Schickman-Hodges model, it's very simple. This is inversion coefficient or normalized current. It simply equals V square, or the square root equals V. It's still Schickman-Hodges, and it's still Schickman-Hodges if I add an exponential in there, but the thing added to turn that into the BSIM6 model is this one. So the addition of a one towards what I had in strong inversion turns that into weak and strong inversion. And needless to say, this is the magic equation to which this EKV and BSIM6 model is based on. I can rewrite in terms of IC, or take the V out of there, or take the V out of there. I'm sure you're eager to see how this looks like. It's an expression which is basic to the operation of a MOS transistor. All transistor parameters are embedded in there. And I can verify that in weak inversion, it's the same as before. And in strong inversion, it's the square law expression as before. It's really combining an exponential and a square law Schumann-Hodges model. And that expression I'm going to plot for you to show how it looks like. Here it is. To show you how we can easily convert any value of VGS minus VT. This is normalized VGS minus VT with respect to this VT plus 70 millivolt. And this is normalized current. Huh? And you see that this is kind of a combination of something linear and exponential. And VGS minus VT is of 0.2 volt, gives you something like 10. You may be interested to figure out some other values if you look at that. For example, 0 volt VGS minus VT. 0 volt VGS minus VT corresponds to something like 0.5 IC. And I can go lower. All low voltage amplifiers work in this region because they have a negative VGS minus VT, and they can go really low with their VGSs. So this shows the unique relationship between the normalized overdrive voltage and the normalized current. Now, how do we add velocity saturation? There is a new parameter there, which is normalized channel length. Normalized voltage, normalized current, normalized channel length. Actually, you see that the new parameter simply says how much your channel length is with respect to a LSAT. And the LSAT is technology. Without L, mobility, KT over Q, velocity saturation, all about 20 nanometer CMOS. So actually, what we have here is a new parameter saying how close your channel length is to 20 nanometer. So of course, if this is 65 nanometer, this is 1/3. Okay. So this is the velocity saturation model, where we reach the maximum GM, which is a simpler model, where we have a parameter 10 to the 7th, but we prefer to replace the 10 to the 7th physical parameter by a LSAT, which is independent of channel length. Independent of channel length. And now we can put everything together. Here is the model, three areas, low current, middle current, high current. As a designer, the first task is going to be, where should be my VGS minus VT? Where should be my VGS? And let's replace that by IC. And then it's much more obvious how to do design in those three areas. So the first step we have to do before we do design is simply say that KT over Q is so much, N is constant, mobility is constant, VSAT is constant, and for my channel length, which is my minimum channel length, the oxide thickness is about 1/50th. And then I can calculate the oxide capacitance. And there is a specific FT related to your channel length. It's your channel length that determines the specific FT. The specific FT is going to be the FT that I reach at IC1, inversion coefficient 1. But I'll show you that. This is all depending on channel length now. And now let's have a look at those different areas like weak inversion and strong inversion, weak inversion, strong inversion. Those simple models I've shown. I simply do that to show that some of those GMs are derived from currents in a simpler way. The GM over I in weak inversion we know already is always constant, and it goes down with the square root of the normalized current when you go higher. And I can plot all that in a simpler way, like shown here. We are very close now to do design. Designer will have to figure out which normalized current or VGS minus VT am I going to use? Am I going to work in weak inversion where the GM goes up proportional to the current or proportional to the square root or not at all in weak inversion? This is the maximum GM I can ever reach in a transistor. We don't want to work there. GM does not increase and the current does. But maybe the efficiency of the transistor is more important for you, like GM over I, which is constant in weak inversion and goes down with the square root of the current and the current itself. So many people work in there simply because it's the highest GM efficiency that you reach in those currents. Below IC1, this is weak inversion. Okay. Where is that point? The crossover point with velocity saturation is at 1 over lambda C squared. For 65 nanometer compared to 20 is 0.3. 1 over lambda C squared is about 10. So we have a range of 1 to 10 in values of IC in the 65 nanometer technology to work in. Because if I look now at FT speed coming in, which is of course copied from GM, simply divided by CGS, then we get speed, and speed goes up if I go to higher currents. So now, if I pull in two figures of merit, the GM over I and the FT together, GM which represents noise, so I would say this is noise, speed and power, all in the same figure of merit. Then you see that when I put the two together, we have a curve that goes up and down, showing that actually the middle current region is still the most interesting one. This is strong inversion, weak inversion, velocity saturation. So as a designer, unless I want to give up all the speed, I prefer to operate in this region between 1 and 1 over lambda square. And clearly for different channel lengths, all the curves are going to change. It's going to be different in 20 nanometer, where both points coincide. But in 65, for example, the range of ICs between 1 and 10 is what I'm going to use as a designer. So indeed, between 1 and 10 are the values which limit my inversion coefficients for 65 nanometer. 65 nanometer, which determines the lambda C. Questions after this, that's the figure of merit. Figure of merit is simply how much speed I get for the capacitance I drive and for the current. And for an IC10, for example, for an IC10, I get something like 1500. It gets better for smaller ICs. This is why people are interested in smaller ICs. But you don't want to go much lower than 1, because if you go lower, you kill the speed, but you improve your amplifier figure of merit. So the questions I could raise after this is, how about going to another technology like 40 nanometer? How about 20 nanometer? For this course, this MOOC course, let's simply go to 40 nanometer instead of 65. What are the corresponding VGS minus VT values of that range that you have? You know the values, the minimum value here and the maximum value there, limiting your strong inversion region. And then if you work in there, what are the corresponding figures of merits? If you can answer that, you know how to design with the new BSM6 model, going deeper into weak inversion. Thank you for your attention.